I have a keynote from yesterday. My computer crashed after that, so I obviously don't have the rest.
Oh yeah.
But
No, I've got nothing except the very first maybe 2 minutes.
okay.
You texted me to say to remind me, which was useful.
Can you allow me?
J'ai pas entendu, like you're breaking up. Hi Vincent. Bonjour Vincent.
Hello, how are you? Bonjour.
Good. Hi. Do you have a PowerPoint?
Yes, I do. Yeah.
Okay. Do you want to quickly start sharing just to check that everything's working before we start?
Okay, let me just start that right now. Okay.
Brilliant.
There we go. So
Parfait.
working? Okay, great.
Super.
Merci. Pour arrêter, c'est là. Voilà.
Voilà, bon, ben comme ça, tout le monde sait quoi faire. On est bien. I'll wait for a couple more minutes and then we'll start introducing our speakers. Yeah, good. Great.
Done.
Perfect.
Thank you, Vienna.
No, of course.
Good. Yeah, done. Okay, well, I think we are going to start to, at least I'll start introducing our speakers. So thank you all very much for joining us for our second day of this conference on anthropocentric thinking. So yesterday we had a panel on time, which was really interesting. And today we have a panel on, sorry, same thing happened yesterday, on anthropocentric thinking and
Imagined futures.
imagined futures. Thank you, Jen. Very tired still. Okay, and it is my great pleasure to introduce David Farrier, who's our second keynote speaker. David is a professor of literature and the environment at the University of Edinburgh, and his current research is in literary responses to environmental change and the Anthropocene. He is especially interested in the way contemporary poetry responds to or can be read in light of these issues. And he's interested in issues to do with deep time and the difficulty of imagining environmental futures. He's the author of Anthropocene Poetics, Postcolonial Asylum, and Unsettled Narratives. But today he'll be reading from his most recent book, Footprints in Search of Future Fossils, which will be translated into 7 languages and which is going to come out quite soon in French, I'm told. So it is our great pleasure to be listening to David read from his book. David, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much for having me. Every conversation yesterday, I'm listening and chatting from my book Footprints. That's the UK cover, in case anyone's interested. That's what it looks like. It is out in French in March, I think. Well, I don't actually have a copy of the cover for that, so watch this space. So what I'm going to do is read from 3 different sections of Footprints to give a sense of the range of different kinds of what I've called future fossils that the book examines. There's a loose kind of thread running through this, which is to do with storytelling and the different kinds of stories that we are telling to the deep future. So I'll there's a bit of a kind of connecting material that I'll read to introduce each extract as well. So, imagine you could tell a story that would last for nearly 40,000 years. The Gunditjmara people of southeastern Australia have a tale of four giants, creators of the early earth, who arrived on land from the sea. Three strode off to other parts of the country, but one stayed behind. He lay down, and his body took the form of a volcano called Tapok in the Daurud Wurrung language, while his head became another called Budjibim. When Budjibim erupted, so the story goes, the lava spat out as the head burst through the earth, forming his teeth. The story occurs in the Dreaming, the mythic time in which what the world was made according to Indigenous Australian cultures. But we can also place it in geological time. The discovery of a stone axe beneath tephra layers deposited when Budjibim erupted around 37,000 years ago suggests that humans were living in the area and therefore could have witnessed the eruption. It would have been sudden. Scientists think the volcano might have grown from ground level to tens of meters high in a matter of months or even just weeks. Other Gunditjmara legends describe a time when the land shook and the trees danced. Budjibim could be the oldest continually told story in the world. But today we have our own long story to tell. The climate emergency doesn't just affect those of us alive now, it reaches into the lives of generations yet to be born. Sea level rise will take many hundreds of years. The last trace of our carbon won't be weathered from the atmosphere for perhaps 100 millennia. Jan Zalasevic, the chair of the Anthropocene Working Group, writes of technofossils, combinations of novel and natural minerals that will form layers in the future fossil record. These anthropogenic lithologies vary wildly in scale, from entire cities of concrete and steel and glass, to everyday plastic objects, to microscopic particles like fly ash. All of these traces are legacies, stories told to the future. In writing Footprints, I wanted to discover what kind of story we're telling. And I see it as a kind of practice of energeia. In the rhetoric of ancient Greece, energeia described the capacity to speak of the future as though it were happening right now. The poet Alice Oswald translates energeia as bright, unbearable reality. What is revealed to us when we contemplate our impact on the deep future is not always easy to face, but we have an opportunity and I think an obligation to do so. Thinking about the things we're surrounded by as future fossils is a way to peer beyond presentism and to visualize the deep time dimension of right now. So, as I said, I'm going to read from three parts of Footprints, each addressing a different future fossil and the kind of stories they tell. First, plastic, then nuclear waste, and finally, DNA storage technologies. Plastic, first of all. Plastic is a miraculous subject. There's probably never been a material so receptive to making our desires real and tangible. But while plastic has been such an integral part of our story for the past 70 years, we rarely consider what story it has to tell of itself. And this is down, I think, to how we've been encouraged, even trained perhaps, to perceive it. The earliest plastics were prized for their durability, but following the explosion in new plastic products following the Second World War, the plastics industry began to preach the gospel of disposability. In 1955, Life magazine ran an article celebrating throwaway living. And we know where this has got us. There are thought to be 5 trillion individual pieces of plastic in the world's oceans. Plastic tends to fall out of view when we aren't using it. Even when it's in use, it's easy to let plastic fade into the background of our senses. It's presented to us as a material without a past or a future. but the durability of contemporary plastics, so much greater than that of the early synthetics, means it is a deeply storied material. So in Footprints, I attempt to tell the story of a single PET bottle from its origins in the phytoplankton blooms of the Neotethys Ocean 145 million years ago to the future that follows when it's used and then thrown back into the water. In my story, this particular bottle is dropped in the Yangtze River and makes its way to the East China Sea, caught in a way where it joins countless other pieces of plastic waste. And this is where we pick up the story. The bottle has now been in the ocean for several decades. For the most part, its encounters in the Gaia have been fairly benign, nudged aside by a leatherback turtle in pursuit of a plastic bag, or its underside brushed by the searching mouths of surface feeding fish. Although it has received a number of irritable pecks from unfortunate seabirds with their beaks clamped shut by six-pack yolks and threads of netting. Once it passes over a pod of humpback whales on their annual winter migration from Alaska to Hawaii. Several have tangled cords of plastic chafing angrily at their fins. Each one has close to half a ton of plastic in its guts, depositing a slur of toxins in the tissues. One calf is struggling to keep up with the pod because its body has been flooded with poisons that saturate its mother's milk. Severely weakened, it has no more than a couple of days to live. The whale calf will not make it to Hawaii, but the bottle does. One summer morning, more than three decades after it entered the water, the bottle is washed up on the southeastern tip of an isolated beach. A northeasterly wind bullies it across the black volcanic sand to where the tide line gives way to scrubby vegetation, shaded by ironwood trees. The beach is crescent-shaped, a long scoop of sand bounded by a rocky headland, and very little that passes its open mouth escapes from the bowl of its belly. Cradled in this mess of cotton buds, cigarette filters, yogurt containers, burst gallon drums, and hundreds of identical fellow bottles crimped into shallow V-shapes, the bottle comes to rest. In the months that follow, many of the objects will be preyed upon by starving petrels, hunger deranged by the plastic already clogging their stomachs, their necks garlanded with gaudy debris collars. But caught in a rocky cleft away from the tide line, the bottle eludes the gaze of the famished birds. Instead, it submits to the more insistent, punishing eye of the sun. Its foulant layer soon died away once it left the water, and washed by the rain, it has nothing to protect it from the fierce glare. The years in the ocean have already darkened it considerably, allowing its surface to absorb more heat and hastening further its oxidative degeneration. UVB radiation begins to unpick its molecular knots, leaving it brittle. Milk-white cracks appear along its flanks. At this rate, stranded on the beach, the bottle will be broken into fragments in just a few years. But its journey isn't over yet. A violent winter storm rips across the beach and tears the bottle back into the water in its chaotic backflow, pushing it round the lip of rock and once more out to sea. As it did when it last entered the water more than 30 years ago, the bottle again begins to attract a biofilm of microorganisms. But the sun has considerably weakened it, and even though seawater shelters it somewhat from ultraviolet light, the film can no longer protect the bottle from disintegration. Waves pound it. Crustaceans clinging to other hard plastics abrade it. Finally, the split seam along its side widens and the bottle breaks apart. The rough edges of its broken pieces attract more foulant, and now considerably less buoyant, they begin to sink deeper until they fall below the point where sunlight can penetrate. The bottle's fate is now multiple. The molded base and neck are the first to sink. Other fragments persist near the surface long enough to be separated into smaller and smaller pieces until what remains of the bottle has become a host of thousands of microscopic particles. Because it does not biodegrade, the fragmentation of plastic can continue almost indefinitely, down to the molecular level, but most of what was once the plastic bottle finds its way to the ocean floor before them, in the bodies of dead fish or carried down by underwater currents. Larger shards and tiny particles alike circulate in undersea depressions, following the routes of submerged canyons and past seamounts decked with torn polypropylene fishing nets like vagrant kings. There are now too many pieces of the bottle to follow individually, perhaps too many even to count, so one piece will have to represent all the others. By now, the bottle has been in the water for more than 350 years. This particular fragment, no larger than a bead on a child's bracelet, drifts across the southern face of a vast seamount below the Hawaiian Ridge, which holds the Midway Islands above the waves, and into the path of a copepod, a tiny crustacean with a cyclops eye in the centre of its head and long, branching antennae. Rapidly spinning its swimming legs, the copepod generates a miniature feeding current, drawing microscopic dinoflagellates and plastic microfibers towards its mouth. The current catches up the sliver of bottle, which sticks to one of the copepod's legs, along with dozens of plastic pellets and polystyrene beads gathered up by its frenzied activity. When the copepod dies, its intestinal tract sealed by a coil of blue nylon smaller than an eyelash. Its body settles in a large cleft at the seamount's base and inters the last fragment of the plastic bottle in a rich deposit of thick mud and synthetic waste. Plastic debris has collected in this cleft for the past 400 years, encasing each fragment in an anoxic layer of sediment that will preserve it effectively for all time. Burrowing creatures will mix up the layers to some extent, leaving their own trace fossil paths, but not enough to prevent a deep seam of plastic from forming in the geological strata. After this, it is a familiar, long story of heat, pressure, and time. Over the coming millennia, hydrocarbons leach from the fossil plastic, accumulating in small deposits and setting in motion a slow chemical return to the bottle's origins in the rich, dark material patiently accumulated in subterranean chambers beneath the Neo-Tethys Ocean. So the story of the plastic bottle addresses one of the countless unintended stories we're telling to the deep future through the kind of durable materials and legacies that we're leaving. But there are also efforts to communicate deliberately across vast timescales. The problem of safe long-term storage of nuclear waste has vexed engineers and politicians for decades. How do you convey a sense of the danger of this material across a distance of, for instance, 10,000 years? Language is poorly adapted to communicate on this kind of timescale. Just like nuclear waste products, all words have a half-life, typically around 750 years. To take English as an example, in 10,000 years' time, only 12% or so of the most basic terms currently in use, words like I, you, here, and so on, will still be in circulation, if indeed English is still spoken at all. Semiotician Thomas Seebach proposed a way to circumvent the erosion of language. He devised an atomic priesthood of experts who would guard the truth of the stored nuclear waste in a ritual designed to be handed down through generations. Every three generations, the new priesthood would update the message to keep pace with linguistic change. Other solutions to the problem of safe storage of nuclear waste try to bypass language altogether. At the waste isolation pilot plant in Carlsberg, New Mexico, the United States plans to install above the repository site 25-foot tall granite monoliths decorated with human faces of revulsion and disgust based on Edvard Munch's The Scream, the idea being that the kind of the vivid nature of a human face grimacing in pain and sickness is far more effective than any kind of language-based communication. However, on Olkiluoto, on Finland's Bothnian coast, engineers are taking a radically different, non-communicative approach. to the problem. The repository they're building, called Onkalo, will store 120 years worth of waste in tunnels carved 450 meters down in the bedrock. Cast in ceramic pellets, the waste will be housed inside 4.5 meter long copper canisters and buried deep in the rock. Once the repository is full, it will be backfilled to the surface and left unmarked to be forgotten. In writing Footprints, I was fortunate enough to visit Onkalo, and the extract I'm about to read describes what it was like to stand in one of those deposition tunnels, 0.5 kilometer under the surface in the bedrock. But first, to make sense of part of this extract, you need to know the story of the Sampo in Finnish mythology. The Finnish epic poem, The Kalevala, tells of how the blacksmith Ilmarinen agreed to forge the Sampo, a wonderful and mysterious object, in return for marrying the daughter of Louhi, the mistress of the dark Northland. Ilmarinen labored day and night without success, but on his fourth attempt, he succeeded and delivered the Sampo to Louhi, who buried it in a copper seam 9 fathoms deep within a hillside and secured behind 9 unbreakable locks. The Kalevala does not say what the Sampo looked like or exactly what it was for, other than that it was a source of great wealth and a highly desirable object. The only description that's given is an alternative name for the Sampo used throughout the poem, where it's called the Bright Lid. Something else that you need to know about this extract is that the two guides who took us below the surface were called Pasi and Jari. Our last stop was to visit the research tunnels, where engineers are perfecting the method for final disposal. There were 3. One was busy with engineers digging a borehole. Another, where they had been testing how to close each disposal tunnel, was blocked by a concrete seal. But the last, in Goldilocks fashion, was open. It was much narrower than the access tunnels we had passed through, blind at one end and coldly illuminated by arc lights. The walls were draped untidily with cables, and a generator and spools of more cables had been left at the back. Set into the ground, evenly spaced, were 3 enormous circular concrete lids, each perhaps 1.5 meters across, with a small square hatch in the centre. Jari lifted the hatch in the first and shone his torch down into the cylindrical borehole 8 meters deep. To my surprise, there was a flash of lime from a pool of water at the base of the borehole. Jari said that they dyed the water sometimes to track where it flowed through the rock. Despite the clutter of construction materials, the only word I could think of to describe the tunnel was holy. This is where the final disposal of spent fuel rods will take place, a sanctuary set aside for the deep future. It was unexpectedly, profoundly moving. The disposal tunnels and access roads will be backfilled to the surface, but if anyone in 10,000 years' time was tenacious enough to dig their way down here, and it would surely be much easier to remove the clay and backfill materials than to excavate the original bedrock, this is what they would see. I felt jolted forwards in time, as if my own feelings suddenly mingled with the future visitors' rush of excitement. As the concrete seals were lifted and the gleam of the copper canisters caught the light again after thousands of years of being buried upright in the dark, would they feel horror, exhilaration, or reverence? I could imagine their gasps echoing in the small tunnel as they raised the concrete seals to reveal the shining, bright lid. Would the Sampo still be remembered here? Might they even think they had discovered the source of the myth? I asked Pasi if anything would be left in the tunnels before they were backfilled. They'll probably take anything of value, he replied. But it looked to me that much of what would be left down here would speak of the people who laid this vault in the earth. Not just the disposal chambers and their thousands of canisters, but the mesh and concrete coated walls, the deep score marks, the pipes that will carry hot water to the engineer's showers. I was startled to realise that of all the many roads I'd travelled since I walked across the new bridge over the Firth of Forth at the start of my journey, this one I was standing on, hundreds of metres below ground, was the one most likely to survive as a future fossil. When nothing of the road network remains above ground, the 42 kilometres of roads through Onkelo will still be here, backfilled but intact, with their smooth surfaces and arcane signs like the emergency exit markers with their running figures. I wondered whether a future intruder would read these as a warning to flee from unseen dangers, or an encouragement, an invitation to hurry on through the door into the dark. Possiva's report on final disposal predicts what will be left of Onkelo beyond 1 million years from now. Plate tectonics are unlikely to have much effect. Serial glaciations may erode the surface level plugs and some of the backfill tunnels, but equally, over this time frame, sedimentation may push them deeper underground. After tens of millions of years, the repository will perhaps have risen to the surface, wearing away the access tunnels and exposing some disposal chambers to the air. If this happens, some deposited material is likely to be dispersed into the environment, but by this time it will be no more deadly than naturally occurring uranium. Over the very long term, it may even come to resemble the uranium bodies it was drawn from. The copper canisters may have been partially reduced to copper sulfides, but because of their low solubility, they ought to be largely intact even at this late stage, raising the possibility that still gleaming remnants of the final deposition may be excavated 400,000 generations after it was sealed underground. Jari beckoned us further down the access tunnels where a new branch had been begun. It was totally dark, but as he shone a light on the walls, they suddenly erupted with life. Our waving flashlights revealed a tangled undergrowth of green lines, spray painted by geologists tracing the cracks and fault lines in the bedrock. Each one was numbered, and the numbers and red dots looked like flowers and buds, like vines living in the deepest rock, clinging to the dark walls of Onkelo for all time. So, moving on then to the final future fossil, which is DNA storage. Microbes were the planet's first great shapers. 2.7 billion years ago, photosynthesizing cyanobacteria raised oxygen levels in the atmosphere to within 10% of today's levels, supercharging the evolution of complex life. They are the source of many of the world's minerals, and the authors of every key life process. But many of these processes now carry our imprint. Human activity has vastly accelerated the carbon, nitrogen, and phosphorus cycles, and in just 300 years, through many kinds of industrial processes largely, humans have created more than 200 new minerals never seen before on the planet. Having thought about the stories we don't mean to send in the form of waste plastic, and the ones we desperately want to tell our descendants about the dangerous materials that are part of their inheritance, in the final chapter of Footprints, I look at how microbes might help preserve some of our oldest stories for eternity. Since the rise of data streaming services, artificial intelligence, cloud storage, social media platforms, and the ubiquity of smartphones and smartwatches, it now takes only a couple of days to produce 5 billion gigabytes of digital content, equivalent to all the digital information that existed prior to 2003. By 2025, the total created annually will be over 160 zettabytes, or 160 trillion gigabytes. Global silicon reserves provide only a tiny fraction of what we would need to permanently store all the data we produce. But a single gram of DNA can store 455 trillion gigabytes. Pak Chun Wong, a researcher at the Pacific Northwest National Laboratory, began to think about the problem of data storage in the early 2000s. The problem wasn't just the enormous quantity of information, but that the means of storage were insecure. For thousands of years, we have overcome entropy by leaving deliberate traces of what we know. Writing has allowed us to beat time and speak to the future, but so far, the materials available to us have been fragile. Bones and stone erode, Wong wrote. Paper disintegrates and electronic memory degrades. Life, on the other hand, is in its essence defined by the safe transmission of information through time. Wong imagined that he could exploit this very basic fact of life by converting binary information into the four nuclear bases of DNA, with A for 00, G for 01, C for 10, and T for 11, and safely enclosing it in the genome of living matter, where, in theory, it would be retrievable forever. In 2003, to test his idea, he encoded the lyrics of the Disney song, It's a Small World After All, in the genomes of two bacteria, E. coli and D. radiodurans. That same year, the experimental poet Christian Buch read Wong's paper and began to wonder if he could use bacterial DNA not just as a surface to write upon, but also as a writing partner. Since then, at a cost of hundreds of thousands of dollars, he has been trying to turn D. radiodurans into a machine not just to preserve information, but to write an eternal poem. D. radiodurans was discovered in 1956, living in a tin of corned beef. Scientists in Oregon were experimenting with the preservative potential of gamma radiation when they found a bacterium they couldn't sterilize. Its name means the dire seed, immune to radiation. It can survive extreme desiccation and 1,000 times the dose of gamma radiation lethal to humans. At 3,000 times the exposure that would kill us, the bacterium is weakened but still viable. In 2002, NASA exposed a sample of ultraviolet solar radiation 300 kilometers, a sample to ultraviolet solar radiation 300 kilometers above the Earth for over 6 minutes. But D. radiodurans returned to Earth unharmed. Its extraordinary resilience is simply down to its shape. The bacterium consists of four cells arranged in a snug ring and looks a little like a hot cross bun. Radiation damage breaks DNA apart, but D. radiodurans' tightly bound shape means that the DNA is kept closely together even when it is broken, allowing the microbe to rapidly repair itself. To the best of all knowledge, it is unkillable. A poem written in the genome of D. radiodurans, Christian Buch imagined, would persist on the planet until the sun itself explodes. A few days after I visited the Ranger uranium mine in Australia's Northern Territory, I met up with Christian in Darwin, where he teaches creative writing. Just a few hours before I was due to fly back to Sydney, I found myself hurrying through the sauna-like streets of suburban Darwin to a seafront cafe on the rim of the continent to meet a poet endeavouring to write a poem that will live forever. The sea had turned lavender under the intense sun, and I was sweating and flustered when I arrived. Christian, by contrast, was relaxed and easy. I ordered a cold juice while he drank an espresso and a glass of sparkling wine and explained his process. Whereas researchers like Wong looked for ways to preserve encoded information unchanged, Christian's aim was to encourage the bacterium to alter what he wrote. The core of the project is a pair of sonnets called the Xenotext. Individually, the sonnets are named Orpheus and Eurydice. The first step was to find a cipher that would allow him to write a poem that, when read through the cipher, would translate the first poem, Orpheus, into a second, entirely different one, Eurydice. I discovered the poems rather than wrote them, he said. He designed a computer program that searched nearly 8 trillion possibilities. Most of them simply produced nonsense before arriving at a viable cipher that would transform one readable poem into another. So the first lines of Orpheus, any style of life is prim, becomes "The fairy is rosy of glow," the corresponding first lines of Eurydice. Having done this, he selected 26 codons, sets of three nuclear bases, which act as instructions for translating DNA into RNA, and assigned each to a letter of the alphabet. When the sonnet Orpheus is translated into synthesized codons and introduced into the bacterium, D. radiodurans should read the poem as a set of instructions for making a protein that, when read back through the cipher, emerges as Eurydice. Like Orpheus passing through the underworld in search of his lost love, Christian's poem enters the unkillable bacterium in search of its partner. In Ovid's poem, Orpheus is permitted to enter the underworld on the condition that he doesn't look at his wife until they are back at the surface. But at the last moment, he is unable to help himself and has to watch her fall back into darkness. Orpheus's grief at losing Eurydice a second time overwhelms him, so much so that even after death, his severed head continues to sing a lament as it floats on the waters of the Hebrus. His shade passes to the underworld again, where this time he is reunited forever with his wife. There they stroll together, side by side, Ovid writes, or sometimes he leads the way and looks back, as he can safely do so now, at his Eurydice. On New Year's Day 2019, copies of Orpheus and Eurydice passed Ultima Thule, a belt of rubble left over from the formation of our solar system 6.5 billion kilometers from Earth, on board NASA's New Horizons spacecraft. And an extract from the sonnets now lies on the surface of Mars, included in the payload of the InSight lander. Christian has gone to extraordinary lengths to ensure the longevity of his poems. But if his experiment with microbial life is successful, the xenotext will outlast every other future fossil. A million years from now, when the nuclear waste inside Onkalo is no more dangerous than a slab of butter, and cities like New Orleans and Shanghai are pressed flat beneath several kilometers of mud and clay, D. radiodurans will continue to write. When the only remaining traces of human presence on the planet's surface are the featureless, wind-eroded faces staring blindly from Mount Rushmore, it will be unmoved. Until the dying sun absorbs Earth, Orpheus and Eurydice will persist in their duet. For now, though, Eurydice remains elusive. After 14 years of experiments, Christian managed to verify that Orpheus had been introduced into the bacterium, and that it was making a protein in response. But so far, he had been unable to synthesize the protein and bring Eurydice back to the light. D. radiodurans wasn't cooperating. "It's like I'm negotiating with this organism," he said. "It doesn't matter what we try, curse it, break it apart, it refuses to engage." He smiled ruefully. "It's like trying to appease a little god." That's me. Thank you.
Thank you, David, for this wonderful reading. It was a real treat for us. Can you hear me okay? My screen's telling you that. Yeah, okay, good. Yeah. So we are going to take a few questions now and then more questions at the end after we hear the three presentations. But I'm just going to ask you questions straight away. And I had two questions to ask you. What struck me when you started reading was how beautiful the writing was. And I was wondering, you know, in a bookshop, where does your book sit? Does it sit with the academic books? Is it with poetry? Is it with sci-fi? Because I think you're doing something very interesting with this book. And I was curious about that. And then I was also curious about the process of writing the book and what kind of literature you read, because you know, I'm sure it must have been quite a process. So if you can, I don't know.
Yeah, thanks. Well, I wish I could give a firm answer about where it sits in the bookshop, but the book came out in March last year, and I've barely had a chance to go into a bookshop to see it, to be honest. We've been locked down for much of that time. I think it has appeared on, it depends on the bookshop, Nature Writing, that dreadful category you sometimes see now, Smart Thinking. It's popped up there a few times, which I don't even know what that means. Environmental sections. But I guess it has been quite a difficult book to place. It does come from a lot of different directions, and that's reflected in the in the material I was reading, and that's informed it. I did a lot of pushing myself to read material I didn't really understand, to be quite honest, about nuclear waste storage or the physical properties of plastic and its long-term future. So there was a lot of reading into disciplines that are very far from what's my background, which is literary studies and particularly poetry. But I always wanted to bring it back to that idea that what we're talking about here are traces that, if they persist, will tell stories about who we are, how we lived. There's a strong narrative, there's a strong communicative, there's an intimate dimension to these legacies that we're leaving, whether that's the geological traces of our megacities, these vast accumulations of concrete and glass and all kinds of synthetic materials that are so large now that it's inevitable some trace will be left. So there was a way into thinking about this that involved reading through a lot of kind of material science, physical sciences and so on, but it was always about bringing it back to that idea that this is about stories. So in going to I went to Shanghai to think about how a city becomes a fossil, and alongside reading about the work of the Anthropocene working group in speculating about how these processes would unfold, I was reading J.G. Ballard's memoir of his time in Shanghai, I was reading Italo Calvino's book Invisible Cities, and thinking about other ways, the more imaginative ways of framing our relationship with this thing, this concept of the city that has been such a vital one in human history for the past 8,000-10,000 years.
Wow, thank you very much David for your answer. So you can either raise your hand or drop your questions in the chat if you want. Do we have more questions? Oh, Cécile, go. Cécile Roudot.
Yes, thank you very much for, I'm going to try to put my video on. Thank you very much for this beautiful reading. I just have a question, because this morning I was teaching I was reading my students, Amitav Ghosh, The Great Derangement, and so how the modern novel kind of accommodate the big, the wild, and climate change. And so I was wondering if you had, as a writer, if you had encountered the same questions. For example, the first story, it's a story, it's not a novel, it's a story. You took a fragment of plastic. So I was wondering which kind of former questions you have asked yourselves, if you had, and also who's that, what is that narrative voice in the first fragment? What is it, in fact?
I guess it's a classic omniscient narrator, really. It's a speculative exercise. It's a thought experiment, I guess. What prompted me to do it was reading Primo Levi's chapter on carbon in the periodic table, where he follows a molecule of carbon, through eons of and iterations. I think the question that I kept in the front of my mind in thinking about the kind of stories I wanted to tell was what will connect people to that sense of intimacy that I see there between right now and the deep future? That sense that, we live in a very urgent moment when, we're thinking about problems that are, the crises that are pressing very urgently on our attention, that have huge implications for life as it will be lived by us and people in the decades to follow. But there's a very long-term deep time dimension to this as well, and that's not something sort of chilly and distant to my thinking. That creates a real intimacy between us and people who might be millennia away from being born. And I wanted to find a way to create that sense of intimacy, which is one form of moving between scales, and there are others in this, in the kind of story I tell, moving between the scale of a kind of human comprehension and the enormous numbers that come up when you look into this these kind of things, whether it's, you know, timescales that run into millions of years or huge quantities of data, of, you know, the trillions of gigabytes that I was referring to earlier, and how to make that kind of scale accessible as well. So that was the question that was always motivating me, was how to find that kind of intimate purchase on things that might otherwise just, you know, drift beyond our comprehension.
No, thank you. It does work.
Oh, good. Thank you.
Do we have more questions?
I actually have one, thank you so much for the reading. I was wondering, and I think that sort of ties in with what you were saying about intimacy and this idea of narrative and storytelling. Something struck me in that first bit you read about plastic is that it's, because it sounded, you know, a little bit like a children's book, you know, this sort of, and here we follow the little, you know, piece of something, you know, the little object. And I felt that intimacy, that attempt at creating intimacy, it worked for me, not necessarily with, when thinking of, you know, future generations, but just thinking about that object. And I found interesting in the work you do, how to me it sort of works to connect me to things around myself rather than really helps me to project myself, you know, into the deep future, or at least into that connection with people from the deep future. And I was wondering, isn't there something slightly problematic about that sort of that format, the story of which clearly elicits a sense of empathy, right? We like the little plastic bottle and we sort of accompany it. And and I was wondering, you know, is that something that's necessary because we need to connect however we do it just to become aware, or is that something that, you know, should be questioned maybe in some way, that we're in danger of developing those feelings for those horrible that horrible waste that we're leaving behind.
I see what you mean. Yeah, well, I mean, I hope I didn't anthropomorphize the bottle too much. Well, I appreciate that is almost a byproduct of telling a story, is that you become invested in the protagonist, whoever, whatever that protagonist might be. And it's kind of heartening to hear that, to be honest, because one of the things that I wanted to do with Footprints was help people to sort of look at the things around them that you might only see in one context, or perhaps not even really perceive at all, and think about, you know, what happens to them when we put them away from ourselves, you know, in space as well as in time. In terms of it being problematic, I mean, I think I see where you're coming from with that. And we do have to be careful with what stories can do to manipulate our sympathy. But I think that, you know, it's by the same token, it's such a powerful tool for collapsing that sense of distance. And that is so much the problem with plastic. We can treat plastic the way we do, we can use it the way we do, because we are so invested unthinkingly in a notion of an elsewhere and away, a place that is not here, where we can just put it, you know, we can park it, we can send it when we don't need it. And that, of course, you know, is a byproduct of a kind of colonial and neo-colonial mentality, and there are all kinds of very problematic legacies that are being played out in that way of looking at it. But you know, to kind of collapse that distance, I hope, is kind of a way to show up the way that we rely upon that idea of an elsewhere and away from here, and, you know, a time that is not now, to facilitate the, you know, wasteful and extractive and exploitative lifestyles that we have kind of become addicted to. Sorry if that sounds a little bit overjudgmental.
No. I think that's just the right amount of judgment, actually. thank you.
Do we have more questions for now for David specifically? No, so maybe there'll be more questions at the end after hearing the two other papers. So thank you very much, David, for your brilliant reading. So I'm now going to introduce our next speaker, Vincent Jonas, who is the author of a doctoral thesis entitled Subjectivity Through the Prism of Reflexivity in the Work of Stanley Kubrick from 2001, A Space Odyssey to Eyes Wide Shut, which he defended in 2019. He's also organized an international conference on Stanley Kubrick in Bordeaux in 2017, and he's given many papers and on Stanley Kubrick, as well as published lots of papers on Stanley Kubrick, the cinema, and transhumanism and posthumanism. So Vincent, the floor is yours.
Great, thank you very much, and thank you for having me. So unsurprisingly, I'm going to talk about 2001 A Space Odyssey today and what it can tell us about anthropocentrism. So I'll just share my screen and try to show you my PowerPoint. There we go. Yes, great. All right, so let's go. So in 1964, Kubrick told writer Arthur C. Clarke of his intention to direct the first, I quote, proverbial really good science fiction movie. And 4 years later, 2001 A Space Odyssey, arguably became the first science fiction film to be set in space, which was given a blockbuster status. And indeed, it was the MGM's most expensive film to date. So it's easy to see why the studio put so much faith in the film, because it was released about a year before Neil Armstrong set foot on the moon. So it benefited from the extraordinary momentum of the space race. And as a result, one might have expected 2001 to be a highly anthropocentric film, one which celebrated the human power to conquer the universe, and in the process, which celebrated American scientific and political superiority. So to a certain extent, it is possible to find those things in the film, because in the future of 2001, human beings do seem very proud of their scientific achievements. And the film does advertise American companies. I don't know if you can see it here, but we have the Pan-American logo on the spaceship, which actually carries the astronaut on the space station here. Yet these elements are depicted with a lot of ironic distance, because human pretensions are pit against the unfathomable immensity of time and space. And indeed, with 2001, Kubrick and Clarke, who eventually co-wrote the screenplay, went against expectations by turning the film into a demonstration of humanity's inconsequential place in the universe. So today, I'd like to discuss several ways in which this anthropocentric outlook of 2001 goes against expectations. So first, I'll briefly come back to Kubrick and Clarke's vision of the anthropocentric shock awaiting humanity on the verge of the space age. And then I'll focus on the issue of representing anthropocentrism through film. Finally, if I have time, I'm not sure of that, I'd like to suggest that 2001 does not foster the feeling of existential dread that one might expect from such a perspective. And instead, it develops a paradoxically optimistic depiction of humanity as a footnote in time and space. All right, so first, I'll briefly come back to the film's unexpected anthropocentric perspective. So rather than celebrating recent spatial achievements, the primary focus of Kubrick and Clarke was to explore as realistically as possible the consequences of mankind's encounter with an extraterrestrial species. And for both artists, it's very clear that such an encounter was bound to strike an unprecedented blow to our anthropocentric worldview. There we go. I don't know if you can read it properly. Maybe I should actually take that down so that you can read the whole thing. There we go. So in a text called The Universe Around Us, that was written as part of a press book advertising the film's release, Arthur C. Clarke recounts the philosophical shock that such an encounter will entail, according to him. So I quote, "Modern man has existed for perhaps 1,000 generations, but the universe may be a million times older. We must, therefore, be amongst the youngest creatures to walk the cosmic stage, and our position in the hierarchy of the universe may be humble indeed. Whatever the truth may be, we must be prepared to face it, as not so long ago we had to admit that our Earth was not the center of creation and that we ourselves are part of the animal kingdom with uncomfortably close relatives grinning at us from the cages of our zoos. So not only does this text shed light on the film's ambition to make viewers experience the unfathomable lifespan of the universe, but it also points at the anthropocentric shock that for Clark would result from an encounter with an evolved alien life form. And Clark clearly echoes Sigmund Freud's famous overview of, you know, the three great blows that would be inflicted by science to humanity's, I quote, naive self-love. According to Freud, Copernicus's defense of heliocentrism, Copernicus's defense of heliocentrism and Darwin's theory of evolution, as well as Freud's very own theory of the unconscious, all caused narcissistic wounds that forced people to question their anthropocentric worldviews. So for Clark then, our encounter with an alien species would represent no less than humanity's fourth great narcissistic wound, and perhaps even the greatest of them all, because our tendency to view ourselves as the center of the universe would become ostensibly obsolete once confronted to a more evolved species. And a look at Kubrick's own production notes also gives us another clue as to the intent behind 2001. In a 1966 letter that he addressed to his publicist, Roger Karras, Kubrick summarized the main points that he hoped to develop in 2001, and among which are the explorations of, I quote, unanswered questions, as well as the depiction of the universe focusing on its size, and on the fact that it is, to paraphrase English biologist J.B.S. Haldane, not only stranger than we imagine, but stranger than we can imagine. So here, Kubrick manifests his desire to not simply evoke the size of space in order to entertain the viewers, but also to shed light on the immensity that lies beyond the scope of human perception and comprehension. So now I'd like to say a few words about the way that such an outlook is actually conveyed in the film. In a book called L'Univers en l'Homme, Thomas Schlesser lists four directions that are usually taken by artists to question anthropocentrism in visual arts. And according to him, they can either explore a temporal axis and depict either the ancestral past or the hypothetical future, or they can explore a spatial axis to depict either the macroscopic dimension or the microscopic dimension. And I'd like to argue that 2001 develops several strategies to explore three out of these four dimensions, all but the microscopic scale. So perhaps the most obvious strategy is to focus on the size of the universe, whose gigantic scale renders the human perspective moot. The film relies on both special effects and widescreen projections to, I quote Kubrick, establish a sense of unprecedented size. And as we can see in this screenshot on the left side, there are various very long shots which contrast barely perceptible human beings and man-made objects with the immensity of space surrounding them. In this shot, it's astronaut Frank Bull being swallowed by the surrounding vacuum of space, so that humanity appears very puny indeed. And the temporal axis is also exploited by the film, given its narrative, which spans hundreds of thousands of years. Such a lengthy time span prevents the film from following a human perspective on the events. And instead, 2001 follows, at least three main characters. First, we have an ape man who discovers a mysterious monolith on Earth, which seems somehow connected to him developing a human intelligence. Then a scientist from the year 2001 goes to the moon to assess the discovery of a similar monolith. And a few months later, two astronauts are sent on a mission to Jupiter for an unknown purpose, which later is revealed to be the investigation of the area where the moon monolith actually sent radio signals. So the one surviving astronaut reaching Jupiter eventually encounters another monolith in a strange artificially made environment and is transformed into a non-human entity. So even though the film does follow some human characters, the real focus on the narrative then appears to be this extraterrestrial plan to help humanity evolve past its primitive condition and then past its human condition. The viewers are therefore given a glimpse at the unimaginable timescale through which such a plan unfolds. It's clear that the lifespan of the aliens must be infinitely higher than ours, so that our entire lives must seem utterly inconsequential to them, like the lifespan of a mayfly is to us. The film also and even points out the insignificance of the lifespan of our entire species through the very famous use of a jump cut, matching the bone thrown in the air by an ape man hundreds of thousands of years ago, which you can see in this frame here, to the spaceship evolving in which was then the future, the year 2001, which is presented here. So this jump cut, encompasses all the evolution of human civilization. In other words, all the time it took for human beings to actually evolve into what we are now, everything that forms the background against which our individual existence is measured, is seen unfolding in the blink of an eye through this jump cut. So through these various techniques, the viewers are encouraged to feel the infinity of time and space, of the time and space that stretches beyond the scope of our perception and beyond the scope of our comprehension. An infinity which, the film suggests, may very well host one or several species that are so evolved that they appear godlike from our perspective. However, one may argue that such techniques are insufficient to provoke the desired anthropocentric experience, since regardless of one's effort to decenter the human perspective with film, the very medium of cinema is ontologically anthropocentric, so much so that no amount of space footage or of time shifts may alter that fact. So I'd like to discuss this now. Such a view of this cinematic medium was famously developed by Jean-Louis Baudry in his landmark 1970 article, Ideological Effects of the Basic Apparatus. And according to Baudry, cinema has inherited from the pictorial conventions of the perspective that developed during the Renaissance, conventions that convey an anthropocentric worldview. So according to him, in Renaissance paintings, one is made to feel as the central recipient of the world depicted, as the perspective must determine the viewer's gaze as the central point around which the entire scene unfolds, in order for the perspectival illusion of depth to be efficient. And likewise, the cinematic apparatus projects an image that is determined by the central position of the viewer. So the uniquely cinematographic technique of editing reinforces the impression of centrality of the viewers, who are made to feel like the world is observed from many perspectives, many vantage points, but also that the viewer may feel like the central omniscient perspective around which everything unfolds. So according to this view then, cinema produces, and I quote Baudry, a recentering, or at least a displacement of the center, which settles itself in the eye, and assures the setting up of the subject as the active center and origin of meaning, thus reinforcing what Baudry calls the belief in a transcendental subject. So since 1970, of course, Baudry's theory has been criticized for various reasons, but to my knowledge, no one has ever repudiated the belief that the very apparatus of cinematography may convey an inherently anthropocentric bias. And in this sense, Kubrick's efforts to depict the universe as seen from a non-anthropocentric scale may be doomed to fail. What's the point of showing the immensity of space, the immensity of time, if the viewer is still made to feel like the whole universe revolves around their gaze? Obviously, Kubrick couldn't know about Baudry's article. It hadn't been published yet in 1968. But I believe, that's my hypothesis, that the director must have been at least subconsciously aware of such a problem, because the film systematically develops strategies to bypass what we may call the anthropocentric quality of cinema, and even uses film's inherent anthropocentrism against itself. I would define this strategy as a reflexive acknowledgement of cinema's incapacity to represent what escapes the horizon of human perception, thus hinting at the extent of what lies beyond the scope of the representable. And indeed, 2001 suggests that the film's very condition of existence is linked with human subjectivity. According to Jean-Michel Bertrand, the awakening of human intelligence that is depicted at the beginning of the film appears to go hand in hand with the awakening of filmic representation itself. Because before the ape man that we see on the right side here actually encounters the monolith, I quote Jean-Michel Bertrand, fixed frames create the impression of a world watched from the outside almost objectively. That's what we can see here on the left side. While the film appears to come to life as an aesthetic object, when the creature actually learns to use tools through the use of various techniques such as close-ups, subjective shots, rapid editing, and so on. So this beginning indicates that the very possibility of cinematic representation is shown as inherently linked to the existence of the human perceptual and cognitive framework. The film thus circumscribes the beginning of representation to the very premise of humanity and really seems to awake along with the first human being. And likewise, the film stops at the very first sign of humanity's impending end as the posthuman child that astronaut Dave Bowman has become returns to Earth. 2001 therefore ends when the film actually seems to have stretched to the limits of the representable. Limits which are associated with the moment when human consciousness and human perception are bound to be replaced by something else. So by circumscribing cinema's representational scope to the realm of the humanly perceptible, of the humanly comprehensible, the film draws the viewer's attention to what happens beyond the edge of this realm. Before, during, and after the events that are depicted on screen, 2001 hints at the existence of a myriad of events that are taking place off screen. And the dramatic weight of these events on what happens on screen is enormous and points at the fact that what humanity perceives of the universe and what can be filmed and represented is only a tiny fraction of existence. So the first of these off-screen events is hinted at before the beginning. A 3-minute black screen overture precedes the very opening shot. That's what I tried to show you here, but obviously it's a black overture, so it doesn't show very well in the PowerPoint presentation. But as we later come to understand that 2001 equates the birth of humanity to the birth of the representable, this overture can retrospectively be interpreted as an evocation of a time set before the era of mankind. And if so, then the music that we hear by Gheorghe Ligeti, which accompanies the overture and mixes deep, cavernous tones with eerie vocal music, then suggests that this pre-human universe was not an empty nothingness, but a space inhabited by unknowable and irrepresentable creatures. Such a suggestion is reinforced during the film through the invisible alien presence that so forcibly shapes human destiny. The fact that these aliens remain invisible directly translates Kubrick's wish to depict a universe that is stranger than we can imagine. And in spite of their absence, the creatures are indirectly evoked thanks to their artifacts, the very famous monoliths. The monoliths are opaque, inscrutable objects that apes and humans can only stare at in wonder. So that I would argue that they act as objective correlatives of the aliens' own opacity. A visual reminder that the creatures which made them lie beyond the realm of human comprehension and of filmic representability. And finally, the last off-screen event, which I've already mentioned, evokes the very future of the human race. The film ends with this post-human child coming back to Earth, yet avoids a direct depiction of the future state of humankind, since the creature that we can see is only a fetus, an embryonic state of such a future species, a symbol of the potentialities that await humanity, rather than an attempt at representing them. So the film ends by debunking the teleological bias, according to which mankind is the final stage in the evolution of our species, and instead suggests that our future state is as inconceivable to us as modern humanity was to the ape man. So these three off-screen presences, therefore, reflexively indicate that 2001 acknowledges the representational limits of cinema, a medium which is circumscribed by humanity's perceptual and cognitive framework, but in so doing, turns cinema into an anthropocentric art form that is capable of highlighting the limited scope of humanity's perception by evoking rather than actually representing what lies beyond it. So in 2001, cinema becomes a mirror of humanity's incapacity to view the universe beyond our limited spatial-temporal and conceptual spheres. So now I had actually planned to discuss how 2001 offered a paradoxically optimistic outlook on all this, but I think that I'm running out of time. So maybe I'll just show you this, and I'll just say that the reason I think why this depiction remains optimistic is that humanity is depicted as self-enclosed, cut away from existence, so that this anthropocentric worldview is associated with a kind of death-like state that we can see here with characters in sarcophagi, for instance, and opening up to the outside world, although it means acknowledging our own irrelevance as a species, is also shown as a transcending experience that it is necessary to actually grow beyond our current limitations. So this optimistic outlook, I think, is what may explain why the film enjoys such a popular success today, even though its main purpose was to remind us that we are but footnotes in time and space. Thank you very much. I'll stop here.
Thank you, Vincent, for this wonderful presentation. It really made me want to watch the film again, actually. I'm going to, well, we'll take questions for you afterwards, because I think there'll be interesting echoes with Diane's paper. And so I'm going to introduce our next speaker, Diane Leblanc, who also is one of the co-organizers of this this conference, and who's a lecturer in British Studies at the Université de Lorraine. Her PhD thesis, entitled Optics of Fiction, consisted in an exploration of visual culture through its representations within British contemporary fiction. And her current research explores the interface of visual culture and literature and the epistemics, ethics, and politics involved in the distribution of the sensible as manifested in contemporary writing and audiovisual media. And she's particularly interested in how non-standard experiences of seeing question the ways in which we inhabit shared visual spaces. So Diane, the floor is yours.
Thank you. You're seeing my presentation all right, right?
Yeah.
Okay. All good. I've been bogged down with, IT problems all day, so I'm hoping this works. So we owe to scientific explorations of space and time some of the most sobering reminders that, contrary to what our behaviour as a species would suggest, we are not the centre of the universe. Some of our worst narcissistic wounds were caused by astronomy and astrophysics for the dimensions that they open up within space and time. Considering such space, we human beings are not only reduced to a blip in the unfolding of observable phenomena, our perceptual and cognitive abilities themselves are challenged, conditioned as they are by the scale on which we exist and experience the world. This offends our sense of our own importance, especially in a context where the disproportion of the universe can no longer be compensated for by the anthropocentric concerns of an anthropomorphic God. Given the role played by such scientific re-evaluations of space and time, it might not be a surprise to find in the fiction attached to that scientific tradition a potential for inflicting that same narcissistic wound. As Vincent just suggested in referencing Arthur C. Clarke, sci-fi adds to the notion of space travel speculations as to the existence of extraterrestrial intelligence. And this creates extra opportunities for deconstructing any notion of human exception in the universe. In that context, more cutting perhaps than the concern that a superior alien civilization might wipe us out altogether would be the humorous hypothesis that humanity might not be worth any notice at all. The opening of Douglas Adams' Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy famously offers one such self-deprecating narrative when the impending destruction of Earth turns out to be necessary for the construction of a hyperspace bypass. So the only worse outcome than becoming the victims of the interstellar colonial ambitions of evil aliens would be for our extinction to be a mere side note, a development hardly noticeable on the sort of scale implied by space travel. For that reason, it seems that one of our main concerns in narrating the arrival of aliens on Earth is to define their purpose. In Villeneuve's 2016 Arrival, that is in fact the question which humans aim to ask their visitors and for which they recruit the eminent linguist and our protagonist, Louise Banks. As the formulation of the question reminds us, the purpose of aliens might confirm our central place in their spatial explorations. By focusing on purpose, we propose a specific reading of space and time as oriented by a neo-colonial framework of interpretation. In defining the purpose of alien, we would define therefore a time and space in which to catch them, to reduce their otherness by, on the one hand, supposing their participation in an order of time oriented by such things as intentionality and causality, and on the other hand, by supposing that they perceive space as territory to be gained or lost. In other words, by considering them as colonialists like us. So in fearing the invasion of aliens, we would find a way to think of them still as similar to us and to ascertain that we are the other that they are looking for, including if they're out to kill us. There's a form of anthropocentrism and anthropomorphism at play there, which would make those aliens familiar, if frighteningly so, and keep us well ensconced in the sort of worldview we seem to have adopted as a species. The title of Villeneuve's film and the presence of the monolith on its poster seem to indicate a proximity to that understanding of alien encounter as invasion. But like the story by Ted Chiang, from which it is adapted, Arrival actually takes a different direction. Instead of reducing the alienness of extraterrestrials and capturing them in an anthropocentric time and space by assigning them to them a colonial purpose, the story presents as the main consequence of their visit the protagonist's ability to perceive time differently. By learning the heptapod's language, Louise Banks begins to experience time as they do. While to human, the future remains unknown and unknowable, heptapods see its sequence of events extending from the present moment as clearly as the past. Louise's encounter with the aliens will therefore give her insight in her future. Her marriage with the physicist recruited to study heptapods with her, and the life of the daughter they will have together, that you whose story provides the title of Chiang's original. That change in Louise's perception of time as a result of speaking to creatures from outer space is at the heart of how both story and film deviate from more conventional representations of alien encounters in text and on screen. It is also the means by which human readers or spectators are challenged in their temptation to consider aliens through an anthropomorphic lens by upsetting our concept of time and space and suspending our interrogation of the alien's purpose. It seems the narrative finds a different purpose for those creatures, that of forcing us to reposition ourselves and to make a real imaginative effort in the face of otherness. Both this story and its adaptation bring together two timelines that involve the apparition of an absolutely other being. On the one hand, Louise narrates to her daughter the story of her life from the moment just before she was conceived. Both story and film open and conclude with an intimate moment in which Louise's husband asks her, "Do you want to make a baby?" On the other hand, Louise tells her daughter how she came into contact with the heptapods, which both led to her meeting her future husband and to foreseeing the birth, life, and death of their child. And the actual link between the two timelines remains mysterious until we understand the impact that learning heptapod B had on Louise's perception of time, that she came to know what her future would be so that she made the decision to conceive her daughter, knowing of her untimely death. Our first impression of that connection between the two timelines is entirely misguided, though, as we rely on the deceptive sense of chronology. The first few moments of the narrative cover the daughter's entire life from birth to death. This leads us to assume that the arrival of the aliens followed that of the protagonist's baby, a mistaken assumption that the narrative tricks us into making. In the story, Louise tells us that the colonel's request for a meeting in the context of the heptapod's arrival was, quote, perhaps the second most momentous phone call in my life. The first, of course, will be the one from Mountain Rescue. And then she tells us about going to identify her daughter's body. The mention of first and second suggests a confusion here between the order of precedence in question and a supposed chronological order. This is all the more so as the brutal disclosure of the second person's death as a very, very young woman, she was just 25. This creates an initial impact before the parallel evocation of the alien's visit and of the daughter's childhood. First, then, the loss of the daughter. Second, the arrival that lends its title to the adaptation. Similarly, the opening sequence of the film, and I'm going to need to, there we go.
Memory is a strange thing. It doesn't work like I thought it did.
Sorry, this is a bit bulky, but the PowerPoint, which just wouldn't take the videos. It was there were too much for it. Right, I'm gonna have to. Okay. So that's the very opening of the film, which obviously creates this has this melancholy music, this desperately empty interior, and the fact that it's staged in the dying light of dusk. And within just minutes of seeing this, about 2 minutes of seeing this, we're there, right? So tragic conclusion to that that opening. That all means that we will explain Louise's lonely existence when the aliens arrive through her bereavement, when in fact she is yet to meet the father of her child. So in both cases, the deceptive chronological setup means we gradually correct our initial impression as we realize that Louise's evocations of her daughter in the story and the flashes she gets in the film are not memories, but premonitions. And as we do come to that realization, what happens is we do not simply fall back on our feet the way we normally would if we simply realize that we mistook a prolepsis for an analepsis. What we have to embrace in order for the narrative to make sense is the disorienting non-human perception of time that it entails. The crucial development in the story corresponds to a time-oriented interpretation of the Sapir-Whorf hypothesis, right? Learning heptapod B affects Louise's sense of time. And since she is the narrator, her non-human premonition of the future directly impacts our experience as readers and spectators. This works on the macroscopic level of the narrative sequence. As we saw, we're put off balance. We're expecting one order of events and finding another. But more importantly, perhaps, the effect is felt on a smaller grammatical level in a way that keeps jarring with our sense of flow. I'm referring to Louise's use of tenses here, which mirrors her experience and in doing so disrupts the expected consecutiveness of telling. So if we go back to the passage I just quoted, right, that was perhaps the second most momentous phone call in my life. The first, of course, will be the one from Mountain Rescue. Your father and I will drive out together. I remember the morgue, all tile and stainless steel. An orderly will pull the sheet back to your rear face. Yes, that's her. I'll say she's mine. You'll be 25 then, unquote. So you saw that sort of paradoxical intermingling of markers expected of narratives, such as the preterit, this was, and the verb remember. So intermingling with tenses and modes normally cut off from the past, in this case, the modal will. So this constantly uncomfortable combination, I remember you will, or I remember you are, is typical of the narrator's style and recurrent in the paragraphs devoted to her daughter's story, for she is indeed remembering a future life with her. And Villeneuve found a corollary for the uncanny effect produced by the story's use of tenses in what we might call the grammar of the image, its spatial organization and sense of cohesion. The story did point to a connection between the disruption the alien bring into human time and their peculiar way of inhabiting space. As Louise pointed out, with eyes on all sides, any directions might as well be forward, unquote. And Arrival picks up on this challenge to our concepts and experience of direction and imagines the place of the encounter as one that challenges our embodied sense of space. So I'm sorry, this is a very long sequence and I cut it into chunks, but I felt that it was worth trying to see a little bit of this. So, right. Right, so that's the very beginning of the sequence, after which, right, so that's, so they take this kind of lift and get lifted up into the monolith, which leads us here. So we realize that gravity in the monolith obviously doesn't work the same way it works on Earth, or it doesn't run along that vertical axis that we know. And so then obviously that's the phase where they actually enter the monolith. So Louise actually managed to get there, and then once they're actually in the corridor that that runs through the monolith, that's where the aliens will appear. Right. So I don't know about you, but when you see all of that in a sequence, I was at that point, it was completely lost. Just, I had no idea how this thing worked, which obviously was the point, right? So there are obviously several aspects of the treatment of the image that contribute to create that, creating that sense of spatial disorientation. The monumental scale of the monolith obviously means that from up close, it takes up most of the visual field, so we can't envision it. The dark color and the rough surface make it very hard to distinguish volume and contours. On some of the shots, actually, just it looks almost like just a two-dimensional thing. And of course, the most jarring feature of that monolith is that it does away with that basic human modality of inhabiting space, that is verticality, right? So space travel simply erases gravity. People are just floating around. But the images we get here are more confusing because they retain the connection with the spatial organization on Earth's surface. So you saw those point of view shots that juxtapose humans seen from above on the ground and human on the side inside the monolith, creating the sense of vertigo. You also saw how the throwing of the light rod swaps the vertical and horizontal axes that normally give sense to the image on the cinema screen, as well as our sense of space. And once the protagonists have landed, the quick succession of viewpoints from, you know, from the side, upside down, etc., sort of completes the process whereby we finally have to let go of the point of reference that was the ground, right? This is a space in which spectators have to throw themselves after the protagonists. And as the ominous music indicates throughout the sequence, this disorientation in time and space heightens our sense of human vulnerability in the face of the unknown, right? And yet Louise's acquired prescience points out that even with superhuman cognitive abilities and knowledge, you just can't shield yourself from pain, right? For her, seeing into the future will give her no recourse in the face of the loss of her daughter. And there's a typical ambiguity there in the gift or the weapon that the aliens leave for the narrator, that crux of linguistic and perceptual abilities, which leads me here. So I said the narrative hinges around the Sapir-Whorf hypothesis, according to which one's cognitive and perceptive capabilities depend on the language one speaks. And since the cognitive abilities in question have to do with Louise's perception of time, it is logical to see that the narrative questions the embodied inscription in time and space through a reflection on language. So language obviously is one of those cultural developments that we often identify as one of the crucial differences between other animal species and ours on Earth. But the assumption is that the aliens that would actually find their way to our planet would have some form of language, right? In classics of the genre, however, attempts at communicating with the aliens tend to be short-lived as they start destroying whatever humans they meet as soon as they've landed. Story of Your Life and Arrival play with this convention, right? Our linguist is brought in as part of a military strategy of intelligence gathering on the aliens. And the entire encounter plays against the backdrop of international diplomacy with world power on high alert. But by choosing a specialist of language as our preferred focalizer, the narrative unmakes this kind of military framework within which arrival means invasion and space is necessarily territory to be gained or lost. The military reference is made clear from the start as Colonel Weber recruits Louise, right? And in the film, we're told that she was sought out as someone who already did translations for army intelligence and still has security clearance. And when she realizes she might lose the opportunity to be the linguist on site, she suggests that the colonel ask of a rival specialist the Sanskrit word for war. And then the first words she hears from her future husband are from the preface to her own book and read, language is the foundation of civilization. It is the first weapon drawn in a conflict. So there's room there for language to play a part in conflict and for the narrative to explore the aliens' colonial ambitions, just as others did before it. Indeed, a linguistic ambiguity will be the reason for the escalation of hostilities in the film, as the aliens offer a tool which might also be interpreted as weapon and which Louise ultimately realizes is their language itself. Yet, as the protagonist herself says, that equation of language and weapon is good for blurbs, but it's not really, it's too simplistic to be useful, really. And indeed, the language she's learned does work as an instrument of diplomacy, as it eventually allows her to avert a major international conflict. More fundamentally, language turns out not to be mainly about building bridges or burning bridges between people or species. First and foremost, it is an instrument of othering, the effortful learning of which will alter your perception and cognition. Louisa's time with the aliens allows her to identify two languages, so one spoken and one written, which she identifies as Heptapod A and Heptapod B. The designation necessarily evokes linear A and B, which is interesting in that linearity, in the sense of its a sequentiality, is precisely what heptapod linguistics brings into question. The most immediate characteristic of those languages is that they're actually not connected, right? While human languages are glossographic, heptapod B is semasiographic writing. It conveys meaning without reference to speech. Heptapod A, meanwhile, has a very complex syntax, quote, word order meant next to nothing when speaking the heptapod A. When asked to repeat what it had just said, a heptapod would likely as not use a different word order. And as she learns to express herself in heptapod B, Louise describes how her train of thought stops, how she slowly begins to visualize things simultaneously. And in that context, she explains, I understood why the heptapods had evolved a semasiographic writing system. Why constrain writing with a glottographic straitjacket, demanding that it be just as sequential as speech? Semasiographic writing naturally took advantage of the page's two-dimensionality. Instead of doling out morphemes one at a time, it offered an entire page full of them all at once. And in turn, that explains why heptapod A doesn't follow such clear rules in terms of word order, because it actually mimics heptapod B. So though its letter comes second, which is very human of Louise, right, to call writing the B language, heptapod B, or writing, actually precedes the voice in lending its shape to heptapod expression. That prevalence of space over time in language, and the dominance of the two dimensions needed for writing over that single line of sequential speech, that is what causes the sea change in Louise's sense of time. The semigrams they're described by Louise as almost like mandalas spun out of inky spider silk. And Villeneuve translates these indications into these. So I actually have very, very short. There we go. Right. So he translates these indications into these, right? And you see how the circular shape etymologically refers to the mandala and points to a different understanding of writing as a process, though it doesn't abolish time altogether, right? As the dark ink or smoke expressed by the heptapod slowly coalesces into shape, we see that the calligraphic process works from all sides at once rather than linearly, as seen. Like that. And though the narrative is told following that basic one-directional logic of glottography, right, we are dependent on English after all, a word at the heart of the narrative embodies the heptapod's temporality, in which beginnings might turn out to be endings and vice versa. The name of Louise's daughter in the film is a palindrome, right? Its spelling erases the binary opposition between directions on the page, left to right or right to left. So it almost looks as if the purpose of the heptapod's visit was to let her know that she would have a child. One implication of the Sapir-Whorf hypothesis, of course, is that the heptapod's languages challenge our experience of time as flow and therefore question some of our most basic concepts for describing human action, concepts such as cause and effect, intention, choice, Louise tells us, quote, "I find myself contemplating the way in which premises and conclusions were interchangeable." In that context, and if we go back to the main question we ask of our aliens, what sort of an answer can we expect? So that crucial question on the board and resonating around the globe, what is your purpose on Earth, does find an answer in both the story and its adaptation. But interestingly, the approach to that time and space bound concept differs a lot in each version of the story. While both story and film broach the issue of the heptapod's purpose as a large looming preoccupation, Villeneuve's adaptation does much more to validate it as a concept, right? At the end of Arrival, Louise has one last conversation with a heptapod who tells her that the gift of prescience will allow humanity to help them to avert a crisis 3,000 years hence. So that notion of purpose remains easily graspable in human terms there. It has to do with collaboration and ultimately with self-preservation. In the story, on the other hand, the establishment's single-minded obsession for why the heptapods have come proves fruitless and altogether futile. Louise tells us, quote, "We regularly asked the heptapods why they had come. Each time they answered, to see or to observe. And that vague answer is enough in her book. Although the heptapods seem to be very, very incurious about anything the humans actually do. Officials who assume that the alien silence is a strategy of some sort are presented as very limited in their inability to think outside of a form of human bargaining. And there's no such thing in the book as the revelation brought to the protagonist in the film. Ultimately, Louise recounts, quote, "We never did learn what the heptapods left, any more than we learned what brought them here, or why they acted the way they did," unquote. So while the adaptation makes allowances for the filmic tradition it speaks to, Chang's story takes this unexpected step of just imagining aliens without a purpose, or at least without any purpose that any human might grasp. Further than that, their impact on the protagonist's perception of time is bound to change the concept of purpose itself. In determining that Louise's daughter should die as a young woman, Chang ensured that the revelation of her future would present human readers with an intractable case of conscience. And the story does address the questions that Louise's awareness seems to be raising, that is, should she have had a daughter knowing that she was going to die so young? There again, the text and its adaptation go in very different directions. The film emphasizes the notion of human free will in the face of tragedy, to the extent that Hannah's parents are said to have separated when Louise told her husband what she knew because she felt that he felt that she made the wrong choice, right? In the story, however, the human concept and experience of free will were affected as that of purpose, as was that of purpose, by the development of this simultaneous consciousness. Louise makes this clear by contrasting her situation to that described in classical myths, right? Hers is not a case in which, quote, "circumstances will conspire to make her enact her fate despite her best efforts," unquote. Instead, she muses, quote, "The existence of free will meant that we couldn't know the future, and we knew free will existed because we had direct experience of it. Volition was an intrinsic part of consciousness. Or was it? What if the experience of knowing the future changed a person? What if it evoked a sense of urgency, a sense of obligation to act precisely as she knew she would," unquote. So the story does away with the paradoxes normally associated with time travel and similar non-human modes of being in time. The discrepancy between this approach and the route taken by Villeneuve is confirmed by the difference in the cause of Hannah's death, right? While the daughter in the story died in a mountaineering accident, she was the victim of very rare disease in the adaptation. And of course, because the film did not truly question the notion of volition and free will, the idea that Hannah just fell to her death would not have been coherent with the rest of the plot because her mother could have prevented that accident, whereas she couldn't do anything against an unstoppable illness. Conversely, the accidental nature of the daughter's death in the story really brings home the idea that Louise does not bring tragedy upon herself by trying to avert her fate. Her actions are just, they're seen from a different point of view, but not one that allows her to deviate from her course. One last question remains as to the purpose the heptapods serve as purposeless aliens. In stepping away from the antagonistic interpretation of alien landing, it might look as if we just have lost the political component entirely, right? International politics mainly evidences the foolishness of humans who refuse to recognize their own limitations. The efforts of diplomacy pale in comparison to the labor that is motherhood, and the obligation that Louise describes as part of her awareness of the future replaces any sense of responsibility, singular or collective. So it looks as if in order not to tell a simplistic tale of intergalactic colonization, we just have withdrawn to the sphere of the intimate and we left behind our sense of belonging to a collective, to a species. This is not what Story of Your Life suggests, however. When Louise uses the word purpose in conjunction with the heptapods, which she does, it is to point out the way in which their form of awareness turns their actions into a collective performance. Quote, the heptapods are neither free nor bound as we understand those concepts. What distinguishes the heptapods' mode of awareness, is not just that their actions coincide with history's events, it is also that their motives coincide with history's purpose. They act to create the future, to enact chronology. So while we experience events in an order and their relationships is cause and effect, they experience all events at once and perceive a purpose underlying them all. In that, they are actually more of a collective than the human species are. They are eusocial. To them, any individual action finds its meaning outside of itself in a shared understanding of what is to come. So the future is as self-evident and ingrained to them as verticality is to us. For Louise, who has developed a similar form of consciousness, there is no question of avoiding the pain and loss that will be hers. The intimate itself is political in that even in the deepest recesses of our inner monologue, we play our part in a collective process of becoming. And in Story of Your Life and Arrival, the apparition of aliens in our midst is not meant to facilitate an anthropocentric celebration of humanity's resilience and solidarity in the face of alien enemies. The heptapods are harbinger of death for Louise, but they do not fulfill our expectations as hostile space invaders. Rather, their lack of aggressivity questions, by contrast, our own inability to envisage encounter as anything other than antagonistic and our tendency to project images of ourselves onto other species. If otherness is to be encountered, the narrative tells us, we must agree to lose our bearings, to throw ourselves in a mode of being that does not make sense to us. We must try to experience for a while the full impact that comes with imagining another way of inhabiting time and space. Thank you.
Thank you, Diane, for this wonderful presentation. And thank you to our three speakers for giving us stories, anthro-decentric stories. That's partly why I was confused with the title of this panel, because, you know, in a way, they're also, we can see that fiction is a very effective tool to make us aware of or to decenter us. Thank you very much. So we will take questions now for the three speakers. So you can just raise your hand or just drop them in the chat.
I actually had a question for Vincent and Diane, actually, if that's okay. Because I'm quite curious about the way the papers speak to one another about technology in particular. I mean, you could say that one of the things that Arrival does is rewrite a kind of techno-pessimism, or technological pessimism in 2001 that sees, you know, the root of technology in an act of violence, an impulse towards you know, violence, hostility, and so on. And that famous jump cut, you know, is, you know, directly connects that original violence to what is to come. And, you know, by, I guess, reframing technology as, you know, as also language, and you know, language which performs that function of you know, the reorientation of perception. It you know, that draws us into a greater sense of collectivity, that expands and complicates our sense of time and space, that, you know, it's countering that kind of technological pessimism with a kind of more optimistic view of what technology can be and is. So I'm interested, first of all, in your response to that. I mean, does that resonate with you? What would you say to that idea that there's a kind of rethinking of technology across the two? And then, you know, what does that tell us about the way that, you know, we're thinking about our relationship with technology in the Anthropocene as well? I mean, is there a kind of danger of a kind of techno-optimism, you know, that creep towards the good Anthropocene coming in any of this, if that makes sense? So.
Bastian, do you want to start?
It's up to you, whatever you want.
Yeah, go on if you like.
Okay. Well, maybe I'll just say a few things first about 2001 and the fact that I think there are actually two visions of technology in 2001. It's true that it's a very pessimistic vision of technology when it's being used by humans, but we also have alien technology at the very end, which is utterly optimistic and even utopian. So rather than technology itself, I guess it's the human conception of what technology is for, which is actually so pessimistically depicted in the film. And because humanity uses technology just as basically as weapons, the very first object ever created by a human species is a weapon to be killed on their enemies. As soon as it becomes used by aliens, then it becomes an element of transformation, an element of opening up towards the world and so on. So I would say that there are these two elements in 2001. And in this sense, I feel like Arrival is basically going in the same direction. The alien technology is also so optimistically portrayed. And I was actually amused that you used the word monolith to describe the alien spaceships in Arrival. But it's true, they are like monoliths, but they are ecologically, I don't know, so environmental friendly as monoliths, because they float above the earth, they don't touch the ground, they don't make any air float around them, there's no smoke. So in this sense, yes, it is a kind of utopian technology, isn't it?
Yeah, absolutely. It's actually really interesting that that you say this, because this is one of the points that they make about the that alien technology in the story, is that it leaves no footprint. One of the reasons why humans are just at a loss how to analyze any of what the aliens sort of came with is that it leaves no footprint. It doesn't seem to impact even the air or anything around it, so that once it's gone, it's gone. So that's one thing. The other thing is, it actually, the monolith isn't in itself a spaceship. It's just the space for the encounter to take place, right? Both narratives just really point out that the aliens are not, quote unquote, in the monolith. It's about sort of projecting an image so that the encounter can take place. And I think there's something there as well of just pointing to that kind of old technology that is language, you know, just being able to get into contact, as opposed to the sort of the kind of paraphernalia that would come representing an actual spaceship. And then I would entirely agree, as far as Arrival is concerned, I would entirely agree with what Vincent was saying about that sort of techno pessimism, techno optimism. Louise at some point explains that, so when she starts sort of seeing into the future, she says, you know, that she's hoping, when she just starts getting those premonitions, she says she hopes she won't see that at some point they'll get any technology from the aliens, because, quote, she doesn't want to see what our governments would do with it. And obviously that doesn't happen, you know. The whole yes, establishment are trying to get something from them, from the aliens, and it just never happens in the end, which is clearly, which is met by the linguist as, you know, a relief, clearly.
Thank you.
Thank you. Do we have other questions?
I had a quick question, if it's okay.
Sarah,
Thank you very much. I really enjoyed listening to you, and I've seen both of the films. And I was wondering if you had any thoughts. This is really a question for Diane and Vincent, but also for David, about the idea of this notion of not lack of conflict and a notion of circularity. So I was thinking of the language of the heteropods and the circular axis, and the fact that we also see that circularity a little bit in 2001. Could you see it as a comment on a position which is against the idea of growth and linear teleology? That is, instead of living on a planet as we do now, just to constantly make more things and trash the planet even more, and we've got this idea of growth, of a capitalist growth principle, and that very recently we've been hearing more about this idea of living on the planet quietly, that is, just simply using what's there and not trying to make any big gestures, literally living in a sort of permaculture stasis just to exist. And I was wondering if in the aesthetics of the films that you've been looking at, there are traces of that.
Would you like to start this time?
It's funny that you say that, because I was thinking, actually, I think in Arrival there's something of that circularity that is much more of a consolation against a feeling of linearity that has to do with entropy, rather than, and I obviously, you know, production and capitalism that also leads to entropy, but I think that's the implication of that kind of circular shape, more than anything. And it's, I think that's something possibly, I seem to be seeing danger everywhere, but I think there's something slightly dangerous in kind of that notion of just that circularity, consoles us, and sort of makes it look as if everything can go back, can fit into a sort of pattern of recycling, or, you know, of life and death, but then death begetting life again, when actually, you know, some things are just, they are linear and entropic, and we are sort of running towards catastrophe, and that's it. I was actually thinking about this earlier when talking about children's stories, because I think there's something of that, you know, the idea of the cycle of, the life of, that we tend to, that might in some ways sort of obfuscate that kind of, that scary, you know, line that runs towards, I don't know, better not know what, maybe.
Vincent, did you want to add something to what Jen said, or?
Yes, because I actually think that it's something that is very relevant for 2001 as well. In the Dawn of Age sequence at the beginning, I don't know if you remember it very well, but circularity is always associated with a kind of harmony with the world, harmony with the exterior world, harmony with nature. And the creatures themselves, the ape man, are all round shapes. They are bent on their back like that. They're all round shapes and they seem to fit in the universe very well because they are circular like that. And in fact, these creatures don't know how to fight. They don't eat meat, they're vegetarians. They don't even know how to fight between themselves to gain some territory. So these are fully peaceful creatures. And the more technology comes in, the more evolution kicks in and the straighter humanity becomes. So that humanity becomes a kind of straight line, just like the monolith, which seems completely cut away from the outside world, which is still composed of round shapes. So there is this idea of round shapes equaling harmony and straight lines, just visually speaking, creating a kind of dissonance with all these round shapes surrounding them until the final transformation, in which finally we are back into this round fetal shape, which are so harmonious because they are connected to the earth. And we have the final image, which I showed earlier, with the fetus, the round fetus on the one side and the round earth on the other. So there is this idea of our current use of technology and our current technological becoming, making us into this kind of straight line, which just doesn't fit with the outside world properly.
Mm. Well, thank you very much.
Thank you.
David, did you have thoughts on circularity, or did you think of circularity when writing your book, or precisely not because you're writing about fossils? Like, I was wondering.
I wasn't thinking too much about circularity, although of course, like, behind it, you know, is this idea that one of the factors that makes future fossils so likely is the abundance of the materials that we're generating and our interventions into landscape. So I was thinking about that drive towards growth and proliferation. I don't have too much to say about circularity in relation to the films, but I was thinking about I've been thinking about this idea of consolation. If Jan mentioned something consoling about these kind of narratives, and I had been thinking about how in each film the fact that it's an alien other, a presence from outside that is the catalyst to change or brings a kind of solution to a problem, even if in the case of Arrival it's a problem yet to be encountered. There's a counterpoint to that in the kind of more popular Hollywood blockbuster version. I'm thinking about Day After Tomorrow, these kind of contemporary sci-fi thrillers, how figure a kind of catastrophe. It's a metaphor for climate chaos, I guess. And it's the meteor coming from outside, but it's that displacement of the problem to an external cause is also quite consoling. And I'm interested in the fact that we've got, whether it's a figuring of the problem or the solution as coming from outside is always a kind of consoling feature, and why it is we're not drawn to stories that encourage us to kind of look to ourselves or within ourselves to find these solutions or to diagnose the problem. Mm-hmm. Yeah, but that's tangential to the question, so I should have kept it to myself, really.
No, that's very interesting. Thank you very much, David. We've come to the end of our time, but we've got maybe time for one more question if somebody wants to ask one. I don't know if anyone wants to. But if
I have, oh,
no, go on, Sarah.
This is Sarah. I have one question, but the fire alarm just went on in my home, so I might have to go. But I mean, I know it's just because someone's cooking, but I might have to help. Okay, sorry, I'm going to try to phrase that. I was very interested because yesterday we were talking about the aesthetics of Silicon Valley, and Estelle's very familiar with these questions. I'm not actually, but Vincent's description of the monolith made me think of a Tesla, that doesn't produce any waste. I mean, that's the story, actually it does, because you have to recycle it afterwards, etc. But the films that you were talking about, as David and you said, are more of present an optimistic vision that is not the typical representation of space that we know of, such as in, for, I'm thinking about the movie High Life by Claire Denis that came out a couple of years ago. And so I was wondering if the aesthetics, but I don't know if you're familiar with this, but if the aesthetics of Elon Musk and Silicon Valley shared some characteristics or features, aesthetic features, with these more optimistic movies. So I'm thinking about the narrative. I'm thinking about the sort of fantasy, you know, around these pseudo ecological, I mean, ecologically friendly, you know, but like these projects. Is it, I don't know if my question is clear enough. My brain is in two different places.
I know that, you know, because we're talking about the Long Now Foundation and Stuart Brand, and that sort of like, actually this is quite a small group of people in Silicon Valley, like that are really into also this techno-utopianism. They all read Ted Chiang, they invite him at the Long Now, that they're reading that kind of science fiction. So I think they're all influenced by that kind of aesthetics in fiction, and of course, you know, Kubrick as well. So I do think they're very interested in science fiction and in the way it informs their ideas, I think. Well, from what I know that they have invited Ted Chiang, and actually all the science fiction writers that are quite famous and popular at the time have probably talked at the Long Now. So it's a very small world. And of course, I don't know that, who makes Tesla? What's his name?
Elon Musk.
I don't know if he's at the Long Now, but definitely Jeff Bezos and, you know, Mark Zuckerberg sometimes are there. So I think they're all at least somewhat familiar with that aesthetic. So I don't know if Diane or Vincent wanted to add something, but
I mean,
yeah, I think there's something about these monoliths in Arrival, and the fact that all, you know, everything that's connected with the heptapods, which are clearly, you know, they're clearly a much more technologically advanced species than we are, and everything they use is kind of so it looks so I want to say slick, but it's not exactly that. It just looks also organic and so non-machine like, you know. It's all completely, and I think it makes perfect sense with I don't know about Tesla exactly, but I have this image of you know, those technologies that are meant to be completely seamless and kind of, you know, work their way onto your body without you actually just kind of noticing that those attempts at making those machines as little like machines as we can, you know. Mm-hmm. No buttons, everything is just very smooth, and it all looks very organic, and it's meant to sort of work its way into your life in a very kind of seamless way. So I think in that sense there's definitely something like that going on with that aesthetic.
That's true. Yeah,
thank you.
Just thinking of my iPhone actually, which is pretty pretty seamless. Yeah, I think that aesthetics, but it really pervades what the products that they're making in Silicon Valley, definitely. Mm-hmm. Okay, well, thank you very much to all for connecting, and thank you for your wonderful contributions. It's been really thought-provoking. I'm really thrilled with this. And if you have time, please connect tomorrow for the third leg of this conference, which will be this time about anthropocentric stories. I've got the title right. So thank you to everybody, and hopefully see you tomorrow.
Bye, thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Bye.